Tourism Europe and External Affairs meeting. Our first agenda item this morning is to continue our scrutiny of the future relationship negotiations between the European Union and the UK Government. Can I welcome to the meeting Michael Russell, Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, Europe and External Affairs, Alan Johnson, the Deputy Director, EU External Readiness with the Scottish Government, and David Barnes, Head of EU Exit Strategy and Negotiations with the Scottish Government. And before we move to questions, I will invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for inviting me back. I think I was last at this committee before the summer. And I think, therefore, I should start by reflecting on the fact that we still do not have the details of, or indeed any certainty of, a deal on the UK withdrawal. The end of transition is very near indeed, and it is extraordinary that the outcome of the negotiations are still unknown. But whatever the outcome is, whatever takes place, it will not be a good news deal for Scotland. We have to be under no illusion, and that will be the theme of what I say today. We are faced with considerable and imminent damage which will disrupt Scotland's economy and society. It will be an immeasurably poorer substitute for what we have now in transition and what we had in membership. Now, I've said before about the difficulties of negotiating with the UK. We've raised substantial concerns again and again about the nature of engagement. And I mentioned only now to say that that continues on the issues of readiness. Months passed before readiness material was shared with us and before we were invited to participate in any way in the readiness and preparation structures. We're still not at, by no means close to being at, all the meetings of the key committees. I've written to the committee with more examples. I won't repeat them all here. But it is now less than 30 working days to the end of transition, and there are very considerable and mounting challenges for all sectors and businesses. The evidence you've taken in recent weeks couldn't be clearer. Taking back UK control appears to be taking on significant bureaucracy and chaos at our borders. Third country status will mean full sanitary and phytosanitary procedures have to apply when exporting to the EU. And if anybody's in doubt about that, look at some of the information, for example, that shellfish companies in my own constituency have been bringing to the table and demonstrating. Along with other demands, they face export health or phytosanitary certification, denotification of arrival, presentation at border control points, documentary and ID checks, and risk-based physical checks and sampling. There will be fees for certifier time and a fee for clearance and checks at a border control post. A new UK government evidence suggests that these cost controls will be applicable to all SPS trade, essential trade, food, animals, plants, including from GB to NI. Retailers are openly warning of empty shelves in Northern Irish supermarkets. We're told that the border control post infrastructure in Northern Ireland will not be ready by the 1st of January. Against these requirements, ambiguities and confusions, we are, however, doing everything we can to mitigate the consequences of the UK government's actions or lack of actions. But we will not be able to avert every negative outcome. The practical consequences of the lack of basic information binds all our hands, as well as those of businesses as they prepare, as does, of course, the continuing essential focus on the pandemic. But we are, for example, working closely with banks through the Banking and Economy Forum to mitigate economic impacts and encourage cash flow support to business. Our multi-agency Prepare for Brexit website, hosted by Scottish Enterprise, provides advice, access to sources of financial support, and online self-assessment. And Scottish Enterprise are now proactively targeting around 80 high-value traders to offer support. During November, an additional 500 companies assessed as being vulnerable to Brexit impacts will be contacted and again offered support. And this number will grow to 1,200 ahead of the 31st of December. But much more needs to be done, and we are focused on doing the maximum we can. And of course, Convener, let me conclude by saying we did not vote for this. No one, in fact, voted for a Brexit of this nature, out of the single market, out of the customs union, and having to accept the end of freedom of movement. As your evidence sessions have shown, it is an act of extraordinary recklessness to end the Brexit transition period in December, when so much preparation by business remains undone at a time when the economy and society is hit hard by COVID-19. It has been an avoidable action, It is an utterly irresponsible action. But of course, we will all work to try and assist the people of Scotland, cope in some way with it.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And yes, it certainly is a very grave situation that we are facing. As you rightly said, we've taken a lot of evidence from business and other organisations about the lack of knowledge as to what they're supposed to be preparing for. You'll be aware that I think it was 9 food and drink businesses wrote to Mr Gove several weeks ago asking that in the event that some kind of deal is reached, we know that it's going to be a minimalist deal. If they can pull a deal off in the time, it's going to be a bare bones deal. And they asked for a period of grace following any bare bones deal or low deal. And this committee followed up on that and said that that should apply to all businesses, not just food and drink. We wrote to Mr Gove seeking a 6-month period of grace to allow time for businesses to prepare and adjust. Is that something that the Scottish Government would support?
Yes, of course. I mean, I noted the letter, and I think that any action at this stage to try and diminish the impact are very much worth supporting and worth trying. I'm sorry the letter wasn't entirely unanimous. I think everybody in Scotland should be saying, look, we have to avoid, if we possibly can, as many of the consequences of this dreadful situation as we can. And one of the ways to do that is to have a grace period. Another way is, of course, would have been to have a much more ambitious trade agreement. And the best way of all, apart from not doing this, would have been to extend the transition period. But you know, we would support any and every action that diminishes the likely impact upon business and upon society.
Thank you very much for that. And it's encouraging to know that you support the committee's position on that. I've been looking at your own exchanges with Mr Gove, and I note that in one of his letters to you, Mr Gove stated that there had been, quotes, intensified engagement with Scottish Government officials, and that officials had received, quotes, central case and reasonable worst case planning assumptions for the end of the transition period, which were shared on the 3rd of September. I wonder if you could just tell us to what extent, if at all, there has been intensified engagement, either at ministerial or official level, in terms of the content of negotiations or the preparations. And could you also summarise what this central case and reasonable worst case planning assumption might be, what that information is he refers to?
Yeah, let me deal with the ministerial part, and then I'll ask, I think, Alan Johnson to say a word or two about how the official interaction has been undertaken. I mean, the word intensified is one of the most used words of the UK government, in the UK government's lexicon. We hear it all the time. And very often it's to do with the fact that meetings which should have been held are held anyway. It doesn't relate to the quality of the interaction. And that is really highly significant. I think there have been 8 or so JMC meetings this year. I can't say that any of them have got us to the position where we feel that we have made an impact or there has been an understanding of the point that's being made. And I say we because I think that is killed between ourselves and particularly the Welsh Government, and very often with parts of Northern Ireland as well, and sometimes with the whole Northern Ireland administration. There is that sense of frustration. An example would be that the first meeting, the Northern Irish, which was the first meeting they had come back into the process, asked for a group to be set up of the JMCEN on the protocol because they felt, and we all felt, there was a need to involve the other devolved administrations protocol. It met in June or July, and the meeting simply told us all the things we already knew. There was no intention of engaging constructively and sensibly. And at the most recent meeting, I think myself and Jeremy Miles from Wales reflected on the fact that the terms of reference of the JMCEN, which were established out of a JMC plenary as long ago as October 2016, have never been observed. We've never had oversight of the negotiations. We were meant to have input to the Article 50 letter. That never happened. We've never had oversight of the negotiations. So, you know, I just don't think the spin about intensification and all the rest of it means anything. I think it's pointless. I mean, now we've seen, you know, which is not a surprise to me in the slightest, the real views of the Prime Minister on devolution. It sort of is part of a package. You know, I mean, it doesn't surprise me that the Prime Minister blurts this out, because that is where the current UK government is. But Alan might like to say a word or two about official engagement, because you know, he deals at the sharp end of this.
Yes, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I would primarily echo the Cabinet Secretary's comments about the contrast between quantity and quality. It is the case that as of September, some of the arrangements we'd previously had in planning for no deal during 2019, some of those arrangements or their equivalents were to a degree restored. For example, a few of us take part in fortnightly transition readiness portfolio board meetings, which are UK government's fairly high level, fairly brief, I would say, reviews of progress across different delivery activities. We have more regular meetings now again with our counterparts. There has been, I would say, some uptick in the quantity of information exchange between Whitehall departments and our directorates in the Scottish Government. In terms of quality, that's been limited by really how late in the process we are, how late we are getting decisions on the key issues. What I hear most from my colleagues in the Scottish Government is where there are significant decisions still to be required, and how that is still stalling some preparations on key issues like what's going to happen at Cairn Ryan, what's going to happen in certification of one kind or another. So, it has improved in terms of the level of engagement, in terms of the quality, only to a degree, and probably not enough given how late on in the process we are.
Okay, thank you very much for that. A very worrying situation. Can I pass on to Claire Baker, the Deputy Convener now?
Thank you, Convener. A few weeks ago, we heard from Paul Sheeran, who's the Chief Executive of Scottish Engineering. And Mr. Sheeran described a situation where I think it was a majority of his members who were small and medium-sized businesses weren't really engaged with Brexit and with any preparations that might be necessary. Now, part of that might be because they don't know the preparations that will be necessary, and it might all feel a bit overwhelming. So I was hoping the Cabinet Secretary could say more about what the Scottish Government are doing to try and support businesses. I note in one of the letters you have a Building Resilience Steering Group, which is doing a single response to Brexit and to COVID. So I'm looking for some assurances there's enough capacity there within that group dealing with two huge issues. And also there's a financial commitment that's been made already if that is likely to be expanded.
Yeah, I think what Claire Baker is pointing to is the concurrence issues, which are particularly worrying. Many businesses, and I know this from discussions I've had with businesses over the last few months, many businesses have been completely absorbed by the challenge of COVID, completely absorbed, because they're fighting for their lives, and it's been incredibly difficult. And we did know from previous no-deal preparations, which have been two sets of no-deal preparations in the last few years, we did know that businesses, you took a long time to wake up to the threat of no-deal. Now, those two things coming together have, and still are, very, very worrying and problematic. There's some evidence that the actual take-up of and preparation activity has fallen off, not increased, in recent weeks, because people are, a new lockdown in England, new regulations in Scotland, people are very focused on that survival. So it's not a surprise, though it is a disappointment that we're in that particular situation. In terms of what we're doing, first of all, we're trying, and I think it's very important that we do this, and this is part of our resilience response, that we do recognise the concurrent pressures. Brexit is a very, very major pressure. COVID is enormously central to this. So are the winter pressures that come upon us every winter, naturally. And in those circumstances, we do have to treat them as parts of the same process. Now, my colleagues and myself meet together to discuss this. We are making sure that we understand all the work that we're doing together and the interlinking nature of it. And it is a big task, and I agree with Claire Baker, but I think it can only be tackled in that way. And I think in resilience terms, it can only be tackled in that way too. And I took part in a winter preparation exercise earlier this week, and it is about that concurrence that is really quite important. Now, in terms of what we're doing, well, let me just get, you mentioned the Building Resilience Steering Group. That's providing strategic leadership and coordination, and part of that strategic leadership and coordination also comes from ministers and officials meeting together, and within the SCORE structure, the emergency structure that we have, and we're involved in that. We are working closely, as I said in my introductory remarks, with the banks through the Banking and Economy Forum. Quite clearly, my colleague Fiona Hislop is very engaged with some of the business issues. December, we're going to launch something called the Scottish Customs Academy. We're developing it with the Institute of Exports to support Scottish businesses that export to the EU so that there is additional high-level support. We are guiding people towards the information that exists within the UK government, who have the primary responsibility for this, trying to make sure there's a take-up there. And I mentioned the Scottish Enterprise website and information, which has self-assessment which businesses can use. So all that stuff is in place. And then there's also a place for this type of information giving and discussion so that people understand the challenge and respond to it.
Thank you. Can I ask another question around border readiness? I think a number of members will want to focus on the issue of exports. And the panels we've had so far have talked a lot about exports, but there's also the issue of imports. And I don't know if you can give us an idea of Scotland's, how much of Scotland's economy relies on imports, how important that is to manufacturing and to other areas. It was suggested to us that that was easier, that it was more, that it was clearer at the moment what the importing regime would be, but is there still pressures within the manufacturing and import sector?
Yes, in two ways. There would be direct import pressures, that is, goods that come directly to Scotland, and those come in through largely through the container ports and particularly through Grangemouth. So there's direct import. Some material, of course, transships in Scotland and goes out again into Northern Ireland, into Ireland. That's a particular set of issues. But then there is the much larger issue of materials within a variety of different supply chains, including food supply chains, medicine supply chains, that come in largely presently through the short straits, and then those supply chains spread out across England and into Wales and into Scotland. Now, I think members of the committee are familiar with this, that the further you are up sort of at the end of that supply chain, the more precarious the position is. So the importation of those goods is problematic and could be very problematic if there are problems and pressures at the short straits. And we know, for example, with the lorry parks issue, that there is a preparation for those difficulties and for delays. And indeed, the UK government has warned that there will be some dislocation and an increase in prices. So imports should be treated in a variety of different ways, not all just manufacturing companies saying we need these goods in here to do that. It's also a particular difficulty, of course, in terms of goods of origin. It is very important to know where the origin of goods is in order to know what tariff or what fiscal constraints are applied to them. And then there is the re-exportation. Now, all these things are dealt with seamlessly when you're in the EU, because it's part of the arrangements within the single market and the customs union. You have to start again, essentially. And you can't go back to where you were 50 years ago. You have to start again. And those preparations are very slow, and indeed many of them aren't even in place. My biggest concern at the moment in terms of importation is on the supply chains issue. And I think that is also vulnerable to winter weather. So the time of the year for that is difficult. The other ones, companies are that are aware and woken up to this, are working very hard to secure supply chains, but also they have a difficulty because of the two previous no-deal preparations, that stockpiling, which did exist particularly in the first of those preparations, I suspect will be much less in evidence now, particularly if that requires financing when money is very tight, or whether it requires willing participation from outside these islands where people are a bit tired of it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And we have a supplementary to Claire's question from Stuart Stevenson. And since we have a little bit of time in hand, I'm going to take it. Do we have Stuart's camera on?
Yes, I'm here, convener. Thank you very much, convener. I want to just focus, because of my constituency interests and more general interests, on some issues related to fishing. We've seen this week the emergence of the idea that particular West Coast vessels might re-register at Northern Ireland ports. That's a virtually cost-free and very quick thing that they can do. And of course, Ireland has three ports, Dublin, Rosslare and Cork, that have five ferry routes to the EU that take them to Santander, Roscoff, Cherbourg, Zeebrugge and Rotterdam. Scotland, on the other hand, under the 1998 Scotland Act, is specifically forbidden under Schedule 5 E3 of the Scotland Act from providing financial assistance for supporting services, marine services, which start or end outside Scotland. So what size of a threat is this? I suspect it's not as big as it sounds, because I understand the ferries from Ireland are running more or less at capacity right now, and they're quite long sea crossings. But there is a big issue about the export of live animals, which are very lucrative for many small communities around the coast of Scotland and for many of the catchers. And I just wonder what progress we've made in addressing this issue, because I, up till now, I haven't really heard very much, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I have two aspects of the question, Mr. Stevenson. You know, one is the conundrum within the sea of opportunity campaign, that it doesn't really matter how much you can. You can't sell it. If you can't process it, you can't sell it. And there is an issue then in exportation. And you know, there are different pressures west and east, but you know, I know the west best, you know the east better than I do. But they are broadly related to that issue, but also to the issue of how you get product to market in circumstances of difficulty. And whether those circumstances of difficulty are simply to do with physical transportation, that there isn't enough of it, or whether it's to do with paperwork and delays. Now, all of those things are coming in. I mentioned in my introductory remarks, I think it was Lochfern Langoustines in my constituency, who've quite graphically demonstrated this with a Twitter post that showed the paperwork that would be required after the 31st of December for shipments that presently required only a single sheet of A4. And it is extraordinary, I mean, how this would grow. And if you look, I saw yesterday coverage of, not in the seafood sector, but another area, that a sandwich coming from Northern Ireland into the rest of these islands presently can come seamlessly. And sandwiches are made in Northern Ireland and elsewhere and sold here. But they would require, you know, substantial, I think, five separate pieces of paper. And these would be required, I think, for virtually for every sandwich, certainly for every consignment. This adds not just bureaucracy, it adds cost. It adds very substantial cost, and it takes time. I was talking to, again, in the rural sector, not in fisheries, I was talking to somebody who's involved in exporting seeds of one sort or another from a company in England, in actual fact. And he told me very graphically about the present experience that when they export, as they do export, some of what they have to a non-EU country, they put it in the corner of the warehouse. It requires inspection, it requires a lot of additional paperwork, and they do that. But it's the exception, because presently the majority of what they do goes to the EU, and that requires none of that. It requires a single sheet of paper. It's like sending, if you're sending it to Bruges, it's the equivalent of sending it to Banff. But not anymore, because all that trade will require essentially outside the EU. And this, you know, that adds very substantially to cost, to time, to the operation of that business, just at the time when they're facing the challenge of the pandemic.
I've got a tiny supplementary that relates more to the East Coast.
Mr. Stevenson, you've actually jumped the queue, you know that? If you want to ask your other questions just now, fine, and if you get any supplementaries, I'll bring you in again at the end.
Well, This is my key issue, Convener, so you can put me to the end once I've dealt with it. Quite happy with that. Yes, my little supplementary is just about the export of frozen fish in particular, where often the point at which the exports take place is many months after fish go into store. And this is particularly the case on pelagic fish, herring, mackerel, blueling, and so on and so forth, that are exported frozen. And my understanding is that despite this issue being raised, I believe, at least 18 months ago, we do not know today what the label that needs to be stuck on the outside of a batch of frozen fish should say. Whether it should say GB is the source or whether it should say UK is the source. And of course, the reality is there is no adhesive allows you to stick labels on the outside of frozen batches of fish. So you've got fish that is potentially marooned in stores across Scotland. And it's just a practical illustration of how, you know, really quite small things, it's impossible to get answers. And I just wonder if this is typical of what we're experiencing across other sectors, and whether you, and I've asked almost everybody else, and I know the industry is similarly asked, have any insight. I'd be astonished if you can tell me if it's GB or UK, but nonetheless, I think it'd be useful to get it on the table as just an illustration of the practical difficulties that there are. CabSec.
Well, I'm going to give David Barnes the chance to show that he knows absolutely everything about what's happening with labelling and things of that nature. But before I do, to give him a moment or two to think about this and to see whether he has an answer to it, the issue of small consequences is an important one. There are an enormous number of issues which are, virtually all the issues are unresolved. And these are vital things for each sector. And the more they don't know, and they hardly know anything, it becomes for them. That is, you know, I think it's also particularly tragic, not just that Scotland didn't vote for it, but actually all the evidence now shows that the majority of people right across the UK are not in favour of Brexit, but it's going ahead. And says it is a huge, absolutely enormous waste of time and money, and it will result in us being poorer. There is no doubt about that. We will all be poorer as a result of this action. And that is simply stating a fact. But now I've given David Brown some breathing space. I wonder if he can tell us about sticking labels on frozen fish. He's still muted, I think.
Could we have David Barnes's microphone on, please? We're just looking for David Barnes to be unmuted.
Could David do it manually?
Is that working now?
I can hear you now, Mr. Good. Barnes.
Super. I was obeying the instructions of the technical people to not touch anything unless they told me to. So I'm glad we're on now. Convener, thank you. As Mr. Stevenson suggested, I'm not in a position to give him an answer to that precise question. I think what the question is an excellent illustration of a huge issue that our Northern Ireland colleagues have been raising repeatedly in our interactions with the UK government, both over the negotiations on the future relationship and on the domestic readiness issues. And that's the interaction between the Northern Ireland Protocol, which is part of the withdrawal agreement, already in international law, already an international treaty, the interaction between that and the trade arrangements which will apply in the future relationship between the UK and the EU from the 1st of January, which of course is still, as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, under negotiation. And I'm afraid this of course impacts, Mr. Stevenson's quite rightly mentioned an impact on businesses in Scotland. Of course, the impact on businesses in Northern Ireland is even more acute. And So all the devolved administrations, but led by our colleagues from Northern Ireland, have been trying to press the UK government for clarity about that interaction between the protocol and the future relationship, really throughout the summer and the autumn. We're not in a position to give an answer. I very much wish we were, but I hope it reassures the committee that we're very much aware of many issues of that sort and working hard in conjunction with Wales and Northern Ireland to try and get clarity as soon as we can.
Thanks very much. I'm going to move on now. Our next questioner is Annabel Ewing, and she will be followed by Dean Lockhart. Annabel.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to colleagues and to our panel. I wanted to return to the issue of the food and drink sector, important in my constituency. That there's Murray has a site in Rosyth where there's over 600 jobs involved, plus obviously the families of the workers there. So it's a very important industry for my constituency and indeed across Scotland, as is the whole food and drink sector. I think it's some £15 billion per annum, and 70% is exported to the EU. Picking up on the letter that was sent to the Prime Minister that the Convener has already referred to, in that letter, it was a quite worrying reference to the fact that actually they had sent this letter, I think, on the 5th of November, and they had advised that they had written to the DEFRA UK Secretary of State some 7 weeks prior, but had at that stage still to receive a substantive response. Perhaps in hindsight, that may be have a little to do with his odd comments, odd being one word to describe them, on, I think it was the Marshall this Sunday, that's George Eustace, where he suggested that in the event of no deal and the problem of crippling tariffs that would face some sectors, in particular in our farming sector, he suggested that mixed farmers could just diversify into beef. Now, that was met, I think, by incredulity and also anger on the part of many farmers, including the chair of the National Sheep Association Scotland, Jen Craig, who commented, and I quote, "For a government minister to suggest on national television that our mixed farmers could diversify into beef in the event of the lamb price crashing is quite frankly a laughable response." Could the Cabinet Secretary indicate whether he shares the view of the National Sheep Association Scotland, and could he perhaps provide some more detail as to the hugely negative implications in the event of a no deal, or indeed a low deal? Thank you.
Yes, I did see the interview. I have to say I was pretty incredulous myself, the suggestion that those who are in the sheep sector, and of course there are a substantial number in my own constituency in Argyll and Bute, could in some way miraculously go into the beef sector with no detriment. It is such a nonsensical point of view that I find it difficult to believe that George Eustace could understood the question. I think there's a lot of worry about the food and drink sector. Now, you know, the issue in the first and second time we were involved in no-deal preparations, and we now know, I mean, just to make it absolutely clear, we now know that the only outcomes that happen are a no-deal or a low-deal, that there's nothing better on offer because the UK doesn't want anything better. And that is the only option. So in either a no-deal or a low-deal situation, there will be an inhibitor on exporting, undoubtedly, because it will become a lot more complicated and more difficult. There will be, and reliability of, for example, the export schedules will be put at risk. So for a period of time, it will be much more difficult. So those companies that are reliant upon export will find it harder. There was during the first, I think the first and second period of preparation of no deal, some focus on whether some of that product could be diverted into the domestic market, and that would still be an issue which we would need to and are addressing, whether that could take place. It is not possible to divert all of that produce into the domestic market, but that might be helpful in some way. But I think there's another issue which we haven't touched on yet, which will also need to be thought of. In some parts of that sector, the end of freedom of movement is particularly problematic. Now, it's, you know, the issue of fruit, for example, and fruit growing has been, you know, well ventilated, but so is meat processing. I mean, if you go to a meat processing factory, then a very substantial number of staff will be from Eastern Europe or from other parts of Europe. And in those circumstances, that will become harder for people to work here. It is quite clear from the approach to migration, it is more hostile. And in those circumstances, we're going to see a shortage of labour. So in a variety of different ways, there are problems, not all of which can be mitigated successfully, and not all of which can be mitigated in the short term in any case. So there are problems there. If you add the problem of COVID, then it's very severe.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. Yes, I think maybe Mr. Eustace should go and see what a sheep kill farmer actually does. But in any event, moving on to another very current issue, which has huge implications for the possibility of any deal being concluded, as far as I understand it, and that, of course, is the UK government's internal market bill, which, of course, breaches international law and, of course, is causing a huge problem in terms of concluding negotiations, and indeed has been for future trade deals. The US president-elect has already indicated some weeks ago that this would be a big problem for him if there were any implications for the Good Friday Agreement. Last night in the House of Lords, the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that they significantly rejected, in terms of numbers, the bill as it stands, and I just wonder where the Cabinet Secretary thinks matters will go from here, given the key importance of the bill in terms of its breach of international law as it currently is drafted for the reaching of a deal in the first instance with the EU.
Yes, I think there's two aspects of the internal markets bill that need commented on. One is the breach of international law. Quite clearly, there cannot be a deal with the EU while those clauses are still in the bill. I mean, that's absolutely clear. You don't have to take my word for it. Simon Coveney, the Irish Foreign Minister, made that clear at the weekend. It is simply a sine qua non. Those clauses have to come out of the bill for the bill to be ratified by the European Parliament. And there are connections between that and the position that the incoming American administration will take, who have backed very much the Irish argument that if the bill threatens the Good Friday Agreement, as it presently does, then the bill could not, there could not be a free trade agreement. So that's one aspect. The second one is the devolution aspects, and I am grateful to those peers who have been very firm in their view that the bill is an unacceptable and unwarranted attack upon devolution and needs to be changed. And I want to pay particular tribute to Lord Hope, who brought a significant amendment yesterday on the issue of frameworks. I'd much rather the bill didn't exist. I think the best outcome of this would be for the bill to be reformed. But the Welsh Government had prepared a number of amendments, particularly on the issue of common frameworks, which could and should be used instead of the draconian imposition of rules. The frameworks which have been, you know, well developed and continue to be developed could and should be used as essentially the basis for voluntary work together by the administrations. And Lord Hope moved a significant amendment has been accepted by the House of Lords, I understand, and that would mitigate some of the damage, not all of the damage, some of the damage of the bill. And it is quite clear it had strong majority support in the House of Commons. Indeed, a number of Tory spokespeople spoke on it. I gave evidence last week, I think last week or the week before, to the House of Lords Common Frameworks Committee, who have been looking at the Common Frameworks and have been very supportive of the work being done there. I gave evidence yesterday to the House of Commons Scottish Affairs Select Committee, which perhaps was not quite as civilised an experience as the experience I had with the House of Lords Committee. But again, I think there's an understanding that the Internal Market Bill is an unacceptable piece of legislation, and right across the board. Virtually the only people who support it now are the existing UK Tory government and their apologists within the Scottish Parliament. Virtually nobody else has any time for this bill, and many people who entirely accept the thesis that there should be no barriers to trade within these islands, which I accept absolutely, do believe that the common frameworks would be the way to move forward. And I would just appeal to the UK government again, look, see sense on this, come to the table and let's get this sorted out on the basis of the common frameworks.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his comprehensive response, and let's hope that the UK government is listening and is prepared to be sensible and reasonable. But on the basis of past form, I would have to say, Convener, I don't hold out much hope for that. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Annabel Ewing. And our next questioner is Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. My first question relates to Scotland's exports beyond the European Union, because, as you know, this accounts for an increasing percentage of our trade. And the related issue is the rolling over of existing free trade agreements between the EU and third countries, which the UK government is in the process of doing. A majority of these deals have already been rolled over, including the Japan free trade agreement, which actually goes beyond the scope of the existing EU trade deal. I want to ask the Cabinet Secretary if he supports these free trade agreements being rolled over, because his MP and MEP colleagues in the past didn't support EU free trade deals with a number of countries, including the EU free trade agreements with Japan, Singapore, Canada and Korea. So given that his colleagues in the past didn't support these EU free trade agreements in the first place, does the Cabinet Secretary support these deals being rolled over in order to support Scotland's exports to these countries beyond the EU in the future?
Well, I think you'd have to be, just to be accurate, I think you'd have to draw attention to specific objections or specific parts of previous trade deals. And the wider issue of why a trade deal would be objected to, for example, on issues of human rights and issues like that. But in broadly, you and I would agree, I think, that we are in favour of trade deals. And we're in favour of good trade deals as opposed to bad trade deals. And of course, that's one of the issues, because the internal market bill is based on the assumption there will be bad trade deals and the UK wants to force those through. But I am in favour of trade deals. I'm also in favour of involving the devolved administrations, where their areas of competence are involved in trade deals, so that they are at the table and take part fully and willingly. And the way the UK could get a buy-in to this situation is to learn the lessons, the right lesson, the CETA Treaty. When the CETA Treaty was negotiated between Canada and the EU, there were two lessons that could be drawn from it. The first lesson is the one I think we should take, which is the Canadian government put the Canadian provinces in a room with the federal negotiators negotiating with the EU. And that meant that when federal when provincial responsibilities were involved, it could be delivered because the provinces were there and could agree to it. So if the UK government wishes to have buy-in, then it should involve the devolved administrations in the details of negotiation where that involves devolved competences. Unfortunately, the lesson that the UK government appeared to have taken from the CETA Treaty is one from the very end of the process, where one of the Belgian parliaments, I think the Walloon Parliament, objected to something in the treaty, and it ran through a very difficult patch. And the UK government's view at the moment is keep the devolved administrations as far away from trade deals as you possibly can, because they might disrupt them. If we could make common cause on engaging the devolved administrations in the trade deals so that we can agree what is good, for example, the Japan deal doesn't have anything on micro resistance, which is really important in terms of pharmaceuticals. We could have an agreement and move forward.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that response. Just on the Japan free trade agreement, obviously you'll know that the equivalent EU free trade agreement didn't have anything on micro resistance either. So in that sense, it was a deviation from the EU trade agreement. In fact, the Japan free trade agreement
went. The deal was. It built on the deal.
As you know, the Japan free trade
agreement. You yourself made the point. It built on the deal. So, I agree.
I just wanted to correct that. My next question, Cabinet Secretary, is in relation to the status of the EU Continuity Bill, which intends to keep pace with EU laws after the transition period. Because commenting on the draft legislation, EU officials have said the following: this legislation could create a difficult position for Scotland and wouldn't be effective. Many regulations which are passed by the EU will be difficult to implement in Scotland and will not apply. So given this comment from the EU, Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary whether you've had official talks with EU officials in relation to the effectiveness of the EU Continuity Bill, and if so, what the outcome of those talks were?
Well, I think you'd have to show me the detail of this response. I think there's more to the response, but I do not have that response in front of me. The reality of the situation is we are ready to ensure that we keep pace with key areas for two reasons. One is because it maintains high standards, and indeed I've had a warm welcome of that from EU representatives that I've spoken to, particularly members of the European Parliament who are sympathetic to the issue. But secondly, to make sure that we don't diverge too far from what are high standards, particularly as we're considering how we re-enter the EU. But if the member would like to come back to me with further details of the comments he's made, I'll respond formally to them.
I would be happy to do that, Cabinet Secretary. But on my question of whether you've had official talks with the EU in relation to the effectiveness of the EU Continuity Bill, have there been any such talks?
There is no need to have official talks with the EU because we would, as your colleague keep pointing out, these are things that will be passed by the EU. They will be there and on the shelf. What we will do is to endeavour to keep pace with those. There's no need to have that. I hope, however, as new rules develop, that we will be able to make our views known about them. But of course, those views will only be views. How much better it would be if we were there at the table and helping to shape them. That would be the real successful thing.
Cabinet Secretary, thank you. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Dean. Our next question is Ross Greer, followed by Beatrice Wishart. Ross.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to combine the two biggest challenges we're facing at the moment, and just ask you a bit about government preparedness in relation to a COVID vaccine and how the arrangements that we find ourselves in from January may or may not affect the supply chains involved in that. My understanding is that in the event that, say, we went for the Pfizer vaccine, which is being manufactured in Belgium, arrangements could be made to get the vaccine itself here, a workaround could be found to get that here in the event that wider trading arrangements are challenged. But if it were, for example, the Pfizer vaccine, it requires to be stored at a temperature of negative 80. That's not something that most storage units, transportation units, etc. in the UK can currently do. So there's a whole new supply chain that's required there to get both transportation units that can cool the vaccine and fixed storage units. What work is the Scottish Government doing around the preparedness for a vaccine supply chain in the event that our wider trading arrangements with the EU are challenged?
Yeah, I think, to be entirely fair to Mr. Greer, I would want Jean Freeman to answer that in detail, and I'll ask for her to do so if necessary in writing. The issue of the vaccine, the work that is being done by the four countries, the coordination, necessary coordination that's taking place, all of those matters are matters that the Health Secretary is deeply engaged in, and I wouldn't want to skim over them if we can get some real detail from the Health Secretary. I have tangentially been involved in some discussions about potential difficulties, and the UK government has assured the Scottish government, of course I'm always happy to believe assurances, has assured the Scottish government that they believe that they can protect this particular item from any disruption, and I hope that that is the case.
Thank you. My previous questions, Convener, were actually covered by other members already, so happily get a response to that one in writing from the relevant minister.
Okay, thank you very much. And you don't have any other questions, Ross?
Not at the moment, thanks. They were covered by Dean Walker, actually.
Okay, right, thanks very much. We'll now move on to Beatrice Wishart then.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. We heard last week from the Institute of Directors about the uncertainty and potential costs that may mean it's easier for Scottish businesses to cut out Northern Ireland altogether from the supply chain. And I understand that the regulatory infrastructure isn't in place and there's around 300,000 lorries that go through Cairn Ryan each year. Could the Cabinet Secretary comment on how the Northern Ireland Protocol will affect goods traffic between Cairn Ryan and Northern Ireland?
Well, this is a very difficult and complex area, and there is not nearly as much clarity on this as we require to have. I wrote to Michael Gove this week about the issue of Cairn Ryan, seeking to have some more information, and broadly and basically, and let me outline what the situation is. The goods that go through very often go through in mixed shipments. So there will be qualifying Northern Irish goods, which are meant to be out with consideration of any of the tariffs or additional problems. But then there will be goods that are bound for the EU. There are goods coming from the EU. They don't necessarily all sit in separate lorries. And sometimes there are, because of the integration of the system, it's very complex arrangements. I was speaking to a logistics expert some weeks ago who was telling me about a client he had who delivers goods as they drive through Northern Ireland to the Republic. And they drop these off at, you know, people's premises or elsewhere. And they were facing having to have a separate set of declarations for every single drop. And this was simply impractical. It simply could not happen. So in Cairn Ryan, we need to make sure that the infrastructure is in place to do a number of things. One is phytosanitary inspection, which has to take place and is a legal obligation for the Scottish government in terms of fish, of plants, of live and dead meat. All those things have to take place. There's also the question of what will happen after the initial period, because the UK government said for the first 6 months it will not operate fully. But after the first period, what will be the qualifying goods of Northern Irish origin? How will they be treated? How will mixed consignments be treated? We may have to put in place separate arrangements for traffic, because the space available at Cairn Ryan is limited, as we know. So all of these matters have to be resolved, and who is paying for it also has to be resolved. So I have written to Michael Gove again about these issues, seeking some specific responses and also commitments to financing. But of course, it is late in the day. Nothing will be in place for the 1st of January. It will be very difficult to have anything in place for the 1st of July. But we are entirely aware of the difficulties that exist here. And they will exist for individual carriers. And the point that Beatrice Wishart made at the beginning is particularly important. If it is too difficult, if it is too expensive, and if people just think the game is not worth the candle, then they won't do it. And that will diminish the flow of goods from one side to another.
Thank you. It's certainly very complex and very concerning. In terms of the negotiations on the Northern Ireland border issue, can you say how much influence the Republic, the government of the Republic of Ireland, has, given that decisions on EU borders are generally taken by the EU as a whole? And is the Cabinet Secretary aware of any interventions of the Irish government and anything being taken forward by the other 26 EU members?
Well, I think, you know, one of the distinguishing marks of this whole process has been the solidarity of the EU with a member state, with Ireland, and the concern that they have shown. And Ireland clearly has had the support, you know, that it was entitled to as a member, but it's not been lacking in absolutely in any way. I wish we had that equivalent support, frankly, because, you know, we're in a very difficult and different position. And people, you know, who voted most strongly against Brexit, other people in Scotland who've had no special consideration whatsoever. So, I mean, I think the Irish government, you know, have expressed their real concern. We should all be concerned. We should all be concerned because of the special nature of nature of the fragility of the peace process, the fact that there are always threats to it, and the importance of the Good Friday Agreement. And those are things which we should bear very strongly in mind, and we should be very Island of Ireland. You know, the border in Ireland is a very different border, because it's not only a complex border, but also it's one that has immense cultural, social and political significance. And nothing should be done to imperil or endanger it. And we should all be committed to that. Now, I think we are all committed to that. We've got to make sure that commitment bears fruit and that we don't have any problems with it. So that's the Scottish Government's position, is to do everything we can to support that. And we want to make sure that we work closely with everybody, including the Government of Ireland, whom we keep in close touch with. I have regular discussions with Simon Coveney to make sure that we are having a dialogue.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. We now move to questions from Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Oliver Mundell. Kenneth.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Structural funds have been a key to Scotland's economic development over the last 40 years, injecting some £5.6 billion into a whole range of projects. And as we know, the UK government said that they would develop a shared prosperity fund to replace these way back in 2018. But so far, it doesn't appear to have engaged meaningfully with the devolved nations and provided no detail on how such a fund might work, how much funding were available, and what it will fund in the future. In view of that, what is the Scottish Government proposing to do in order to develop its own structural fund mechanism?
Well, my colleague Ivan McKee has been dealing with this issue. I think that he will have things to say about that in the coming period. We would expect, I think, to know a bit more about this, the Shared Prosperity Fund, possibly through the Comprehensive Spending Review and the spending announcements that are due shortly from the UK government. They're much trumpeting defence spending today. I would hope that there might be some information perhaps next week on the spending on the Shared Prosperity Fund, but at present we don't. What we do know from the internal market bill is that the UK wishes to take powers to spend in Scotland. This wasn't even in the very brief and awkward consultation that they held on the internal market bill, which was, of course, in the middle of a parliamentary recess and only for a month. But that information wasn't even on it. It appeared in the bill when the bill was published. And this is money that appears to be and likely to be through that mechanism, a shared prosperity fund mechanism. Now, I have no objection to people spending money in Scotland. What I have objection to is policy incoherence and waste of resources. An example that was used yesterday with me at the Scottish Fair Select Committee by, I think it's Andrew Bowie, was surely Dean Council should get money direct from the UK government to build roads. Well, I've absolutely no objection if the UK government wants to put more money into Scotland. But given that, you know, transport and road building is a devolved matter, then surely it would be incoherent for the UK government to intervene in that without involving in a key way the Scottish government. So if the UK government wants to say, look, we'd like to see put some more money into Scotland, then let's have a discussion about priorities and the priorities of the elected government, rather than be subject to what's in place.
Yeah, thanks very much for that. I mean, I think I agree with you. What we don't want is duplication and delay because of too many fingers being in that particular pie. But if we look at the next 7 years on EU structural funds, I understand that Scotland would need £1,283 million to replace what we would receive from the European Union. Plus, of course, £183 million from leader programmes and European territorial cooperation. So, is there any indication whatsoever that the UK government are considering providing those resources? And if so, what proposals do they have for rolling out those funds and delivering them to Scotland, the Scottish government directly?
Well, we have no idea what those proposals are. I think we should probably also note that it's not just the structural funds, not just the funds coming through LEADER. There were a number of other funding streams that were very useful. The European Investment Bank monies were very, very useful. Very often the first monies that turned the key on major infrastructure projects. I mean, I could point to my own constituency to things like, you know, the desire of the community to have a fixed link to the island of Lyng. That would have been the type of project, which is essentially not an enormous project, but an infrastructure project that involved a road and a bridge, where the European Investment Bank would have been an obvious place to go to start the ball rolling for raising funding for this to take place. Regional funds particularly, would have been useful too. Those sources of funding have just stopped. They're not there. So that means that projects like that just are not happening at the present moment. Now, if the UK intends to bring monies to the table, then if it does so, it should do so in collaboration with the other partners who are involved, rather than, you know, what looks a bit iffy at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so basically we're in a position where we're in the middle of a pandemic, we've got possibly a no-deal Brexit coming, and then the UK government effectively being posted missing. in terms of ensuring that Scotland gets the structural funds that Europe currently delivers to Scotland. Is that a fair assessment? And if so, what kind of economic implications is that likely to have for Scotland in the very near future, i.e. in the next year or two?
Well, we have published a number of projections and estimates of what we thought the damage of Brexit would be. Those are all on the record, and I'd refer you to them. I think the point I made in my opening remark is germane. This will be damaging economically and socially. There is no doubt about it.
And just lastly, I take on board your comments, the excellent work that's been done by Scottish Enterprise and Scottish Government, indeed yourself and other Scottish ministers, in terms of trying to prepare for what seems to be almost unpreparable over the next few months. And also, you commented on the fragility of small and medium-sized enterprises. Is that the area where the Scottish Government has the greatest concern at this point? Because obviously a lot of small and medium-sized enterprises do not have the resources to perhaps look into this in the detail that is perhaps necessary in this. And there are obviously tens of thousands of these businesses, and Scottish Government itself cannot always reach out to them all. So is that an area where you have greatest concern, or is it in exporters, or where do you feel that the blow will fall hardest over the next few months?
There's a lot of discussion about who are most exposed. Those who are already marginalised will be further marginalised. I mean, there are real worries about people at the end of supply chains, those in rural Scotland. Those who suffer from disadvantage in any case will suffer more greatly from disadvantage. I think in the business sectors, those who are fragile and have become fragile as a result of the pandemic, that fragility will be increased. Those who depend upon exporting, there are many companies who don't, but there are many companies who do, and many providers who do, and many food and drink parts of the food and drink sector that do. All those things are. But there's also the great unknown. I mean, we are still very unsure what this looks like. It's not good, but how bad it is, I think we're going to do our best to mitigate. But it is very concerning.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gibson. We now have Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I just wanted to check that I'd heard you correctly earlier in the evidence session. When you said we would support any and every action that diminishes the impact on business, is that the Scottish Government's position?
It is so. Obviously, we judge whether those actions would be effective, but I am, and we have an open door to try and assist business.
But does that mean that you'll, in the event that there is a deal, which I still think is the most likely, that you'll support it, even if it doesn't offer absolutely everything the Scottish Government have asked for? If it's an improvement on a no deal, will it have your full support?
Well, a deal will be better than a no deal. You know, but the question of full support is a rather curious one. These are really bad things. I'm not going to get enthusiastic about bad things that do an awful lot of damage to my constituents, to the people of this country. I'm not going to welcome a bad deal. But we will work very hard to make sure that we mitigate the effects, thing that should not be happening. That is our obligation, and that is what we will do. But don't ask me to be a cheerleader for people who have created disaster. That I will not do.
I'm not asking you to be a cheerleader for Brexit. I know that you've sought to block it and disrupt it at every turn. I just think if you want to minimise the impact on business, then obviously if there's a deal that's acceptable to the UK as a whole and that the EU thinks is in their interest as well, surely that would be something to unite behind if you're concerned about uncertainty.
I don't understand this unite behind issue. We're going to have to get on and implement something that's really bad. I don't want to do that, but of course at the present moment I will have to do that. But I think I am obliged to do two other things. One is to tell the truth, and I'm sure you wouldn't want me not to tell the truth as I see it, and you and I clearly would have different versions of the truth. And the second one is to suggest solutions that get us out of this situation in as quickly as possible. Now, I'm being entirely honest about that. But please, again, don't put me in the position of saying I have an obligation to support something and cheer something. which is thoroughly bad news. I'll get on and do my job as I've been trying to do it. For the last 4.5 years, regrettably, I've been engaged in this awful experience in something which the people of Scotland did not vote for, and which every opinion poll now shows the people in the majority across these islands are opposed to. So don't ask me to cheer for such an anti-democratic and destructive thing, but do ask me and expect me to work hard to try and help the people of Scotland and the businesses of Scotland, because that's what I will do. I think it is regrettable that the Conservatives have done the opposite.
Yeah, I would just ask you to work constructively and to keep an open mind, because I think if we manage to achieve a comprehensive deal, then that would surely be a positive thing for everyone, given that we've already left the EU and that Brexit is going to happen. But I'll say that as a comment.
The UK cannot achieve a comprehensive deal. The UK has put itself in the position, for whatever reason, of accepting either a no deal or a low deal, a very bad deal. There's no the comprehensive deal, which was on offer, and which I still wouldn't like to leave the EU, but was on offer, disappeared a long time ago. And it disappeared because the UK government threw it out, would not accept it. The zealots
in the way. In fairness, Cabinet Secretary, I don't think anyone's going to describe what's reported to be an 1,800-page document as not being a comprehensive agreement. So let's wait and see what's published and not talk down or diminish the possibility of reaching a negotiation when both sides have intensified their engagement and both sides are still around the table. I think that to me, as someone who doesn't want to see a deal at all.
I'm sorry, Mr. Mundell, nobody believes that what comes out of this will be anything other than the lowest common denominator. That is absolutely clear from where things are. No matter how much spin is put on it, no matter how much effort goes into shaving Boris Johnson's face because the EU would just like to be done with this, the reality of this is a disaster. And it doesn't help anybody if you go whistling in the dark about this. Let us tell the truth.
I'll continue to tell what I see as the truth, and I'm sure people will look at the very constructive comments you continue to make and judge them for themselves. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, thank you very much. That comes to the end of our two allocated questions, which means we have time for supplementaries. If I could just go back to the Cabinet Secretary, and my opening question referred to Michael Gove's letter in which he claimed that there had been intensified engagement with the Scottish Government, in which you very comprehensively illustrated that there hadn't in fact been intensified engagement. But I also asked about an aspect of that letter where he claimed that officials in the Scottish Government had received central case and reasonable worst case planning assumptions for the end of the transition period. Are you able to tell us a little bit more about these central case and reasonable worst case planning assumptions? Are they accurate in your view? Do you know anything about the content of them?
Yes, I mean, these are a standard approach to any scenario planning you would do, which would be to make the reasonable worst case planning assumptions. I think were leaked to the press, if I remember correctly, very shortly. I think before we saw them, actually. I think that they'd been in the press. Alan, I think, can confirm that, but I'm pretty sure that they were leaked to the press before we saw them. And they are there on the record. I mean, as your clerk, simply look them up on Google. It is important to have reasonable worst-case planning assumptions. They often change as time goes on. It's important for various parts of the preparation matrix, including the devolved administration, to be working off the same sheet. We will also have our own assumptions, and they will relate to how we deal with issues of resilience, and therefore we will factor them in. Nothing very mysterious about them, but it is important we're all doing the same thing. That's all really I can say about them.
Right, okay. Thanks very much. And to drill down a little bit into the evidence that we took in the last few weeks, we took evidence from the Road Haulage Association, who talked about the when you're out of the EU, drivers require licences, and there aren't the number of licences anywhere near the number of licences for trade out with the EU to cover the millions of journeys that lorry drivers make. And he was saying they still don't have any more clarity on that, which I found completely extraordinary. I mean, is that something that you have been having discussions about?
We're certainly aware of the problem, and we're aware of the problem with road hauliers. You know, we've supported the arguments that they've made, and we support generally any arguments that say let's have more information and more clarity in the situation. But to be fair, you know, there's a lot of words in it, but you very often don't get much clarity out of those words. And Alan Johnson made a point earlier on, which I think is an important one, is the consequential nature of a lot of these things. You can't get that information sorted until you actually know what the deal is going to say in terms of how haulage and how hauliers will operate, how borders will operate. So, you know, people are saying, we need the answer to question X. And actually, the reality is, in order to get to X, you've got to get answers to questions A, B, C, D, and all those questions first. And that is the problem. Nobody has ever done this. Nobody's ever gone into set trade negotiations essentially trying to diminish what you're getting and make your condition worse. And it, you know, I'm not saying that Brexit, I don't, you know, Oliver Mundell has rightly said, I think Brexit's a thoroughly bad idea. But, you know, I think you have to distinguish between the idea of Brexit and the appalling execution of the idea, the appallingly incompetent execution of the idea over a period of time. I mean, it was a half-baked notion by a group of zealots who managed to get a referendum and by surprise won it with no preparation of what would happen next. And then it has simply been incompetence after incompetence thereon. And a series of bad decisions made which have had implications. When Oliver Mundell, for example, talks about, see what happens out of the treaty. What happens out of the agreement arises from what happened 4 years ago when the negotiating mandate was being set, when the Article 50 letter was setting out what the UK wanted, when the eventually the Article 50 process was over and the withdrawal agreement was signed and the protocol was in place. All of that was leading you down a road. And therefore, what happens at the end of that road in terms of the nature of the final withdrawal, much of that, you know, is dictated by what's taken place. I mean, I've reproduced it again and again and given it to people, but the very early slide from the task force, which I'm sure you're familiar with, and if, I'll make sure officials give it to your committee if you're not, but you must be, which was a stepped slide that showed what the outcomes would be if the red lines were the following. And it showed exactly where we are, and it was absolutely prescient because it said what would happen. What we have ended up with is a choice between a no deal or a very, very poor, very basic deal, not Canada, not Canada plus. Not, I think David used to talk about Canada plus plus, but Canada several minuses. And that is what we will end up with if there is a deal, because that's all you can end up with if your red lines have been as they are. That's simply the fact of the way the negotiations have gone. And you, there's no escaping that.
Thank you very much. The other issue that we talked about with our previous witnesses was that of geographical indicators. Now, I understand that both the UK and Scottish Government accept that these are reserved, but it was interesting that the food and drink witnesses that came before the committee last week were pretty disparaging about the proposed geographical indicator sign that the UK Government had come up with. That was the kind of the mark that would appear on food and drink. It looks like an old threatening bit. I don't know if you've seen it, but they weren't terribly impressed with it. But I just wondered whether they, you know, like you thought that, you know, obviously the branding of Scottish produce over the last 10 years has been really successful in terms of our exports and the marketing of our quality produce around the world. And I just wondered if you thought what you thought about the proposed branding and whether you thought that Scottish we needed to do something separate in Scotland?
I think we need to promote the Scottish produce for the reasons it sells. It's high quality produce. It's produced to high and rigorous standards. Those include banning GM, which is, I think, particularly important in terms of quality and presentation. And I am not convinced that the geographical indicator solution is the right one, and I think more work will have to be done on it. An independent Scotland would want to be very vigorous in promoting its brand, as an independent Ireland is vigorous in promoting its brand and successful in promoting its brand. And we should be ashamed of that. We should be talking about how we do it.
Thanks very much. I have another supplementary from Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Convener. It's a very brief and simple one for the Cabinet Secretary. Reference has been made to an 1,800-page document. How many of these pages has the Cabinet Secretary seen? And if seen, on how many of these pages is there a recognition of anything that the Scottish Government has suggested in relation to the negotiation?
Well, I haven't seen any of those pages because clearly I'm not negotiating, and I claim to be negotiating with the EU. It is that negotiating is undertaken by the task force and by David Frost's team, so I haven't seen them. David Frost has been at JMCs from time to time. His deputy has been at JMCs too. I did actually ask at one stage, I think the Welsh and ourselves asked at one stage, for an analysis. It could have been a checkers process, might have been a later process. We asked for an analysis of what we had proposed and the final document to work out what input we had had. This was rejected, I have to say, by the UK government as not being something that they wished to do. I wouldn't argue that we've had absolutely no influence on things, because I think there are things which we've been able to articulate which they've recognised are essential. But, you know, in terms of what they've ended up with, you know, I wouldn't have gone in that direction. I wouldn't have started on this route. But, you know, if we had been forced onto it as we were originally, then we had a set of comprehensive proposals published in Scotland's Place in Europe in December 2016 and built on since then, which would have provided a compromise. And one of the real tragedies of this is if Theresa May, you know, we've all forgotten about by and large, but if Theresa May had brought together at the very early start of this process the leader of the Labour Party, the leader of the Lib Dems, the First Ministers of Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, and sat everybody down in a room and said, look, we've all got to get something out of this. We've got to get an agreement out of it, which we all feel we can take forward. There would have been, I think, the opportunity of something happening, but quite the reverse happened. We all trooped into Downing Street in October 2016 to be told by the Prime Minister that, you know, she was listening, and we'd set up a JMC structure, and there was no listening at all. And she simply became more and more extreme until she gave way to somebody who was even more extreme. And so it has gone.
Thank you. We have another supplementary
from Dean Lockhart. Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you said that the Scottish Government has not been involved in formal negotiation process on the EU deal. But has the Scottish Government held any informal talks with EU officials on the terms of the EU withdrawal agreement?
No. I mean, we've been very clear. You know, I've met with people in the task force. The First Minister has met with Monsieur Barnier, as Monsieur Barnier has met with First Ministers of Northern Ireland, First Minister of Wales, mayors of London cities and others, to hear their concerns. At no time have we been involved in negotiating. And indeed, we've been quite scrupulous because, you know, quite clearly, we want to say what our point of view is. Our point of view is clear, and I'll give that to anybody who listens. But equally, the task force have been very clear that we are not, nobody they have met in these circumstances are negotiating parties. Negotiating parties are the UK and EU. It was that from day one, and it'll be that until there is a deal done. A poor deal, an inadequate deal, but a deal done. And that is how it is, and that's how it's been.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I don't have any other members indicating that they wish to ask any supplementaries. So at that, I shall maybe just wrap it up. a little bit earlier, which is great. Thank you very much to the Cabinet Secretary and his officials for coming along to speak to us today. And I'll now close this public part of the meeting, and we will continue our deliberations in private. Thank you very much.